next to St. Joseph. He goes, me? Yeah, yeah, you go. We wait here. We wait here. So he said he had to go over the fence into the bishop's residence, you know, and tiptoe and then dig and put, you see, put the little medals at the feet of St. Joseph. And he's coming back. He said, I'm scared to death. He said, Mother Teresa, like, you know, duped me, made me gay, or get arrested or something. He said he got back to the airport and they changed their mind. And they opened the house, the first house in the United States for the brothers was there. Thanks to Saint. So this is the power of Saint Joseph. All right, so we're getting off topic, but you see, Joseph is someone who provides, huh? And he provides for us now. This is happening. If my mama can get me out of a tight crack, certainly Saint Joseph can. All right. All right. So a couple things. We're going to do this quickly because I don't want to keep you as late as I've been doing. Number one, I'm going to give you seven P's for Saint Joseph. Number one, Joseph is present. He's present. What you mean by that? I mean, read the infancy. Read Luke chapter 1 and 2. Read Matthew chapter 1. And you'll see there the presence. That whenever they came, they saw the child and his mother and Joseph. You see, Joseph was present. Joseph was present, you see, when the angel appeared to him and said, don't be afraid to take Mary into your home. Joseph was a present when the shepherds came from the fields and they sang their Gloria. The glory to God that we have at every Mass is from the shepherds, what the shepherds heard from the angels. Huh? And Joseph was present when Holy Simeon says, talked to both of them and took the child in his arms and said, now I can die. I've seen the baby Jesus. I've seen my Lord. Now take me, Lord. I'm good enough to go. And then turned to Mary and says, a sword shall pierce your own heart. Joseph was present there. He saw that. Joseph was present when the Magi came with their gifts. Joseph was present to take the child. Joseph was present. He named the child. He was present at the circumcision. He was present at all these major feasts. He showed up. That's what they told me in the seminary. When I was in seminary, one of the few things I learned in the bad days of seminary was just show up. You know, show up. Somebody dies at 2 o'clock in the morning, a baby or something. Nobody wants to go for that. Show up. Don't open your mouth. If they remember what you said, it's probably you said something stupid. I remember, you know, all these years of taking care of the nine. People say, oh, you were the priest that came. Oh, I see these boots. You're the one that came. You know, nobody ever tells me, oh, you said this and that was so helpful. No, you showed up. Presence. Joseph didn't say pacon. He didn't say anything about the whole, you know, this is my first experience of St. Joseph. I made maybe not my first, but first kind of conscious one. I made the Crucille, and then I was a sophomore at LSU. So, I left Prairie Ruin, and I went, and they told me you got an Altrea. They got this, like, weekly meeting that you go to. And so yours is on Greenwell Springs Road over there. They told me what church or whatever it was. So I went, and I showed up, and I was the only guy. Couple, and I like that because they had like five girls. He was from LSU, and I was the only guy. So I said, hey, this is my kind of youth group. You know, I mean, at the time, that was my interest. So I was going to be back the next week, you know, and not tell anybody, not encourage anybody to come to the Altrea. The odds were pretty good. Well, okay, but they needed somebody to take care of the men's side. Well, I was like the only man. So they said, oh, you be coordinator. I said, what a coordinator do? They said, well, you know, you just got to lead the prayer. The one on page 16, I said, I can do that. Well, what they didn't tell me was, oh, and by the way, give a talk next week. I said, talk? I mean, I didn't know anything. I just made the Crucille. They said, yeah, let's see what's next. St. Joseph. Give a talk on St. Joseph. So I wrote a talk on St. Joseph. Now, it's not, you're not supposed to do that. I wrote a talk on St. Joseph. And then I said, let me see if I can't season it up a little bit. Let me just spruce it up with a little gumbo filet, you know, a little salt and pepper, a little champagne seasoning. And so I said, I'm going to season up with a couple of quotes from St. Joseph. So I went to the scriptures. I went to Matthew, flipped up. Every time I see Mary, you see, and the child, you know, and I see Joseph, oh, okay. And I get my ink pen to write down a quotation. Rien, nothing. You see, and so I read all of Matthew, all of Mark, all of Luke and John, and didn't find a single quotation of St. Joseph. The Lord duped me. He got me to read the Bible for the first time. He got me looking for a quote, you see. Anyway, I gave my talk without any quotes. But see, I realized that Joseph didn't say anything. You see, he was present. He was always present, didn't open his mouth. Now, obviously, he spoke during the course of his life, but we have no recorded words. But Joseph was present. This is a problem. Men are not present. The church is too feminine. Now, I understand theologically the church is mother and virgin, and we're all feminine. We all receive grace, so all of us are receptive before God. But I'm talking about males and females. There's not enough males in church. See, running their youth group, football, women. I saw a study recently, like 70% of those who like doing sports in church are like women. Are you kidding me? You know, where's the men? We do Bosco. We have Oratory Don Bosco in St. Martin for street kids. Because all these kids, they're raised by their grandma, mamas. Mama's on drugs or something, and so grandma's raising. Mama doesn't know the daddy, they don't know their daddy. And the daddies are absent. Or the ones that know their daddy, they're not there. So we did this big thing with the bishop coming over and all. We had the youth choosing a saint, and they gave their presentation. The bishop was really mesmerized by that. Each one had chosen different saints over the course of the history of the church and why they chose it, and told a little bit about the saint and all that. And then they made a little, some arts and crafts to give to the bishop. You know, it was our second anniversary. And look, they invited their guardians and stuff, their parents or whatever. And I look around, and a good turnout. All women, not a single man. I said, echo, voila, this is the problem. See, this is the problem. So Joseph is present. He even closed his boutique. He closed his shop. And old Bernstein, who didn't care maybe much about the law and about being present, was eating his business alive while he was gone. But he was there. He showed up. And so it doesn't have to do anything. You got to show up. This is number one. Joseph is a man who's present. And we need to show up and be present. This is a very biblical friend encounter. Be close to people. This is Cardinal Ratzinger before he became the Pope. When people complained about the different things going on in the church, he says, the shepherd is with the sheep. The priests were complaining. He said, about the sheep. He said, the shepherd, you priests should be with your people. Get to know them and show up at the different meetings. You see, and then you get you know what's going on. That's encounter. Okay, all right. Number two, Joseph provides. He's a provider. You see, no big talk, no quotations. Joseph was a doer of the word. He follows James perfect. St. James says, you know, be ye doers of the word. I don't want to hear lip service, romantic talk, poetic utterances. We need action speaks louder than words. And we see that with Joseph. So he provides. Somebody's got to feed baby Jesus. Somebody's got to, you see, clothe baby Jesus. And let me tell you, men, this is deep in us. You see, the need to provide. Laziness is not something that looks very good in a man. Doesn't look good in a woman either, but we can maybe slide it by a little. It might not be as much of an eyesore in a woman as for a man. So good work ethic. This is one of Bishop Provost's four things for a seminary. He says they got to, you say they got to pray, huh? They got a modicum of intelligence. They don't have to be a bright light, but yeah, at least you got to be able to articulate the faith and know what it explains to somebody. You know, he says they got to be orthodox. We don't want to know their opinion or the teachings of other groups. We want to know the Catholic Church's teaching. So orthodox and good work ethic, hard worker. We need hard workers, you see. So Joseph was a worker. In fact, we have a feast day to Joseph the worker. And you know, Joseph would have wanted to do better for baby Jesus. And God the Father could have done better for baby Jesus, but he didn't. It's important. So as far as he was, he wasn't a workaholic. He took off of work to be present. He balanced all these other things. Now, look, I heard this, I'm telling you, hundreds of times, I'm sure. I'm not exaggerating. With thousands and thousands of people dying, you were there. I was there. Either I was there when they died, or right before they died, or especially after they died. You know, come bless the body before the funeral home. So I go to the house, and I'm there. Everybody's weeping. We bless the body. Everybody puts the cross on their forehead, and so we're waiting for the funeral home to come. And of course, the man dies, not the woman. You go to the nursing home. It's all women. Because the husband's already in the grave. Right. No, I don't know, it was 7 years that you outlive men by five, seven years or something. So just women live longer, you see, than men. Well, at any rate, so chances are, you know, you'll be laying in the bed waiting for the, you know, for the caretaker, and she'll be standing at your side. I'm just saying, I'm not being a prophet or anything. I'm just saying that's the way the numbers crunch. Well, anyway, that's my experience in many, many years. And what do I hear? My father, I can't complain. He was a good provider. You know how many times I heard that? Hundreds. Now, it's what she's not. Now, you're not going to say anything bad. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I doubt you don't want to say bad things. And that's true. Maybe he was a good provider. And thanks be to God. But that's 20% of it. Well, here now, seven things. And that's less than, you know, that's like 16%. You see? And anybody that took an exam recently, 16 out of 100, you're not going to make the cut. So we got to get a few points on all those essays. And so Joseph was a provider. He took care of Jesus. And yet he didn't take care of Jesus as much as he wanted. And can you imagine being in the cave? You get to the hotel and the $49.95 room that they advertise is no longer available. And they say, well, we got a marriage suite. That'll work for you. Marriage suite, that's $99.99. I don't have $99.99. I had to buy some, I got to get some turtle doves or whatever, you know. What happens? Joseph has to give birth to the Son of God in a vacheri, in a cowshed. Now, men, I don't know about you, I'd be suicidal. I mean, can you imagine, on my watch, the Blessed Mother entrusted me by God the Father, the Immaculate Conception, the All-Holy One, the Mother of God, Mother of the Church, it has to give birth in this cold, cowshed, and the Son of God, who's going to redeem the whole world, is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, in a cowshed? That's making me look pretty bad, you see, that I'm in charge and I can't do better than that. You know, Joseph was humble. He didn't take him, he took God very seriously, he didn't take himself too seriously. And you know, if he wasn't married to the Blessed Mother, I can hear, I knew I should have gone online and made the arrangements, the reservations, you see. Or it stinks, you know, or it's cold, my hair, you know, whatever. I mean, I don't know what he'd be hearing, but the Blessed Mother, you could, oh, thank you, God, for sending me such a wonderful man, Joseph. Oh, yeah, as Joseph is like fluffing up the hay, you see, and kind of moving some cow ties out the way. All right? That's, Mary made it a lot easier on Joseph. Huh? Shouldn't we help, you see, be sensitive to the wound of pride in a man, you see, and vice versa? So certainly Mary helped. So we see Joseph as a hard worker, a provider, teaching Jesus how to work. So much so that in the Bible, isn't this the carpenter's son? Or better yet, isn't he the carpenter? That Joseph taught Jesus so well, Jesus learned from Joseph so well that he had become like the master and become an ace carpenter himself. Not just the son of the carpenter, but isn't this the carpenter? See, he learned how to work, you see, from Joseph. And so men, we need to teach. That's what we're doing at Bosco. We're trying to teach him how to work. Teach him a trade. Teach him how to weld. Teach him how to repair a lawnmower. Change the oil in the vehicle. A flat. Put a cube in a bicycle tire. Dad taught me these things. But some guys don't have dads to do those. All right. So Joseph is a man of prayer. This is your third P. Now look, men, we don't like what we're not good at. And we're not so good at prayer. Women are kind of wired though. Men, women just can kind of just like sit down in the chair, pick up something, and start praying. You know what I'm saying? It's not that simple, but you're kind of wired for it. Men are very exterior. We get more easily distracted. We got to have something outside of ourselves. Whereas women are more interior. And so you have a proclivity. Well, guess what? Male, female, when you get to the pearly gates, you might be judged more seriously than me. You see, I had 10 degrees of prayer. Okay, come on in, Saint. Come on in for the champagne. And then my little sister comes behind me. I had 30 degrees. You're a woman. You should have had 40. I don't know. So let's not judge one another. To each his own. You know, maybe if I had your grace, I'd be a Padre Pio. Maybe if you had my grace, you'd be a Saint Teresa. Who knows? But nonetheless, Joseph was a man of prayer. And it belonged to the man to lead prayer. This is very important for the Jew. You had the inner court right here for the men. And then you had the court of the women. It was the men who were closer to the altar. It was the men who were close in prayer. They had that responsibility. Now, can you imagine it's time to pray? Baby Jesus is born. The Blessed Mother is holding baby Jesus. And, I got the role of St. Joseph. I'm sitting there. And so Mary says to Joseph, baby, don't you think we ought to say some prayers? Joseph, oh, yes, certainly, you know, I'm all for that. Go ahead, Mary, you know. No, you, Joseph, you're the man, you go ahead and lead prayer. Now, Joseph's the weak link. You got to, God, the Son, the incarnate Word of Jesus, teach us to pray. You see, a Hail Mary full of grace, all these prayers to Mary. She's like number two, and Joseph is like the weak link in the chain. And he's not so weak when we look at him. Huh? He's stronger than all of us put together. But nonetheless, who should be praying? I would say, you know, so I'm Joseph. I say, well, Mary, hey, let's get baby Jesus. Baby Jesus to pray. He's just a baby Joseph, you know. We're going to ask him how to pray. And who? Only one who knows how to pray is Jesus. Well, okay, here, Mary, you pray. You're full of grace. Hail Mary, full of grace. You know, the Lord, what, my rosary? No, Joseph, you pray. Joseph led prayer. Jesus learned how to pray from Joseph. This is what St. John Paul the Great says. St. John Paul said, I don't remember my mom very much. And I'm sure she had a tremendous impact on my life. But she died when I was like 3 or 4 years old. Or whatever it was. I don't remember. He said, but I remember my dad. And you know, his dad died when he was in his 20s. He was born to seminary clandestinely after he would work in the stone quarries. And he said, I remember my dad's on his knees. That's how I remember my pop. He said, when I'd come back from the stone quarry late or after classes at night at the archbishop's residence, sneak back into the house, he said, my dad's door was sprung. It wouldn't latch. And the hinge, the way that the hinge worked, it was sprung. And it would always pop back open. And when I'd walk by, I just had the habit of glancing that way. And I could see through the crack my dad on his knees with his crucifix. Yeah. And so he said, that's the icon, that's the image I have of my dad growing up. Now, we put footballs in the casket, we put rods and reels, fox duck call. You say, that's fine. And then we look around, oh, what's that? Oh, that's a rosary. Where did that come from? I've never seen that before. Well, it came with the package. You know, you get a crucifix and a rosary with the deal. 16,000 and you get that included. Well, sometimes we wonder if they ever held one. Will people remember me as a man of prayer? Will they remember my Bujo jokes, maybe? And put a book of Bujo jokes in my casket instead of a rosary. You follow me? No, we tend to die the way we live. And how we die, we live forever. Joseph was a man of prayer. So, you see, we can go to Joseph and we want to imitate Joseph as a man of prayer. Especially you men and me, you see. I remember one time a guy was all confused. No. The guy was joking around. He was a jokester. I went to see him. He was in Louisville, Catahoula somewhere. And I'm talking to the guy. And he's just fun-loving and goofing off and, you know, joking. And he's dying, you know. So after about a half hour of that, I said, you know, I need to get serious with this guy. I need to hear his confession, get him the sacrament. He's going to be dead in a week, you know. So I'm thinking this, all right. So at a certain time, I stopped. I said, Mr. Boudreau now. I said, Mr. Boudreau. I said, you know, you're going to die. Now we need to pray. He goes, you too, Father, you're going to die. You need to pray. Look, man, I had a rosary in each hand going back home. You know, he put me back on the straight and narrow, you know what I mean? So we all need to pray. Okay? Saint Alphonse Liguori says, if you want to be saved, pray. If you don't pray, you'll certainly be damned. That's in the catechism. Quoting from St. Alphonse Liguori. Joseph is a... Number four. One was there. Joseph is a protector. He's got a protect. Man, Herod's trying to kill the child. This is why... Another reason why he's terror of demons. Why the devil's scared... Joseph scares the hell out of the devil. Is because... Not only is his humility... And the devil hates humility. He can't approach humility. You see? Because he's so proud. He can't go in low places. You see? Yeah, he's not willing to stoop, and so if you're short, you can be fine. You see, with big the demon can't bend that far down. You see, but so Joseph is very sharp with regard to his humility. All right, no big splash in Joseph, but Joseph was dealing with the type of the devil, Herod, trying to kill, slaughtering innocents because he was so angry that this child that he was going to kill escaped his grasp. And so much so, they said that he had a son that fell within that time frame. Well, what about your son? He's only a year and a half. Kill him too! That's Herod. Herod was evil. So he's a type of the devil. And who has to fight Herod? Who has to defend the child Jesus and the Blessed Mother from Herod? The devil? Joseph. And he's up to it. Joseph, Joseph, get up, take the child and his mother and go to Egypt for Herod is trying to kill the child. Now, why didn't the angel go to the Blessed Mother? You know? Because it wasn't Mary's responsibility to protect the child. She was to nurture the child. She was to conceive the child and nurture it and feed the child and love the child. But she wasn't called to protect the child. That was Joseph. That's why Joseph's an essential player. And so he went to Joseph. Can you imagine Joseph in the middle of the night? You two women try that. Your husband about 2 o'clock in the morning. Say, babe, wake up. What's the matter? We're moving to Denver. You say, what? No, we're moving to Crot Springs. I don't know. But you say, go back to bed. Well, no, I had a dream. Well, yeah, obviously it was a dream and a nightmare. Go back to bed, Joe. Take some of my Ambien, you know, and get ibuprofen PM or something. Get to bed. No, really. The angel says, you know, who? The guy with the big wings? What's his name? I don't know. He didn't tell me his name. A big blonde, blue eyes, about 6'2", you know, about 270. Yeah, that's him. Gabriel's his name, Joseph. He talked to me. You know, my picture's on the holy card. And St. Marco, you know, in Florence. Fra Angelico put my, you know. And we're going to get a bunch of those at Christmas time, you know. No, Mary didn't. Mary got up and she went with her man. And she let her man do his job. And so Joseph was not in the loop when Mary got pregnant. He didn't get a text message. He wasn't on the text stream. You follow me? And Joseph had to trust Mary. He had to get a little help from the angel. But when it came time to protect the child, Mary didn't question her man. She went along. She submitted. And off they went. And then again to come back. Joseph put that. Men, we got to protect. We got to protect innocence. We got to protect virginity. We got to protect the faith. We're losing it. We're losing the faith. Oh. That's why we need a mission that goes over an hour. You follow me? We gotta try to protect it. We gotta hold on before we. These churches will be museums. Go to Quebec, where our ancestors came from. You see, and pay your $5 and go visit the nice art. Go to Amsterdam. Go to the Netherlands, where half of our clergy came from. The Dutch, like Turlins and Van Boxel. You see, and all these Dutch who came over. Go over there. I was taking care of Van Boxel at Cornerstone, and he said, I'm going home. I said, why are you going home? You're here. You got everything. He said, because my sister is dying, and I can't get a priest in the Netherlands to anoint her. I said, are you kidding me? He said, maybe he was exaggerating, but he flew, 85 years old, back to anoint his poor sister. I've been to Amsterdam, and I paid money to get in their churches. All right? That can happen here in Acadiana. If we don't protect the faith and we don't protect the message, this is what we have a paran and an end at baptism. We tell them, guard their life, make sure that their white garment doesn't get stained with sin. And you see that light, that's Christ's light, sanctifying grace in the soul burning. Don't let that wind of hell blow it out. You gotta protect it. You gotta protect it. You gotta protect the child in the womb. That's the role of the man to protect. That's a warrior. That's a manly man willing to lay down his life. For the family. For the good of sanctifying grace in a soul. Read Saint Louis, Louisiana, our patron, Saint Louis, King of France. Read his dying letter to his son. And he tells his son, he says, die rather than commit a mortal sin. He says, number one, always, always stay in the state of grace. Never, never, never do anything that would destroy God's life in your soul. Boy, wouldn't that be nice to hear from pops when they're dying? Boy, I heard some beautiful things, but boy, I heard some bad things from dying people. Don't let that son of a gun come to the funeral home. Boy, promise me that you know my ex doesn't come over there. Mama, he ain't gonna come around, he ain't gonna come around. And they're at the funeral home. I see him with the shotgun. And I gotta go over there and try to wrestle the thing. That's happened to me. You see? Call that the Port Arthur syndrome. He moved to Port Arthur. He hadn't done anything for his poor mom in 20 years. And then he moves back 2 weeks later. And then he's going to make it all good by, you know, being her, you know, her last dying words, which were terrible. No. Protect. Sanctifying grace. This is St. Joseph. He protects it. Joseph is pure. An evangelical preacher that I won't mention the name. You all know him all too well. An evangelical preacher was preaching away on a Sunday, and I have a priest friend that listens to him all the time. I don't know how he can do that when he has an eye. He must record him and listen to him. And he tells me, he's preaching away, and he says, can you imagine what Catholics believe? And they're like, you know, because they're all Catholic. They're like 80% of them, 90% baptized Catholics in the church. They're like, mm-hmm. He says, Catholics believe that Saint Joseph, Joseph, the spouse of Mary, lived with Mary all their life after she gave birth to Jesus, and they never had sexual relations. Are you kidding me? And they're like, and he goes, are you kidding me? He said, if that's the case, why forget about praying to Mary? Let's pray to Saint Joseph. Duh, that's what we do. That's why Joseph is, you know, the most chaste heart, and we pray in the litany of saints, you know, her most chaste spouse, and in the divine praises, Saint Joseph, blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse. And we got Joseph Cord, and because Joseph lived with the most beautiful woman on the planet ever to come and ever to be seen by the planet ever in the history of the world. And he never touched her or did anything to her in a way that would be harmful to her virginity, her chastity, her divine maternity. Was that his plan? He might have planned to get married and have babies and raise a family like most men would think, in a chaste and noble fashion. And whatever he thought, it was changed, and he submitted that. You see, virgin Saint Joseph. Not an old man. I remember my professor in the seminary. He said, I think it's horrible how they depict St. Joseph on the holy cards. Old man, long white beard, you see, with a cane. Couldn't walk across the street, much less all the way to Egypt. You ever think about that? How in the world is God going to take care of Mary and baby Jesus with an old man? Nothing against being old. I'm getting that way too. I don't think you can trust me with that feat. And nonetheless, Joseph was madly in love with Mary. Young St. Joseph. St. Fulton Sheen says that. I think Father Calloway quotes that in his book from Fulton Sheen. Says, no, the vigor and the vitality in a man's youth, you see, then we can call him most chaste. You see, being in prison doesn't make you chaste. When the body doesn't work anymore, doesn't make me chaste. Having chemotherapy or whatever doesn't make me chaste. Chaste is when you have these desires and you're in possession of yourself and you order that toward God for the sake of the kingdom. That's chastity. Joseph was a man chaste. We need to turn to Joseph in this unchaste world, in this pornified culture. So we got to imitate Joseph, but we got to pray to Joseph. If Joseph, and you know something, I'm sure Mary helped. How Mary carried herself, how Mary treated Joseph. You know, you say, man, to be able to live with Mary and to be, I think it wouldn't have been as hard as I thought it would be, because I'm sure Mary helped Joseph. Women, you have a rule. Men follow women. This is the feminine gene. Women have this existential, ontological, willed by God influence on man. And we saw it yesterday with the role of how Mary influences Jesus and how Eve abused that influence and influenced Adam. Women, I always point to, I love to, in confessional, to talk to women and put them and say, hey, your dignity. If he's not willing to wait, he's not worthy of you. And use your influence, not to draw, seduce. To seduce means to lead to oneself. Dux ducere means to lead. And say means to oneself. Don't lead to yourself, lead to God. That's what Eve was supposed to be. To see, Adam opens his eyes and sees, he sees God being good to him. And you see, to God. And so point to God, you see, not to yourself. So this is what Mary did. And so this is Joseph most chaste. Okay, almost done. Joseph is poor. Poor. Look, we're in a wealthy country. I mean, stimulus checks or whatever, but you know something? We live pretty good. You see, we don't worry about our next meal too often. Okay? Many people do. And I've dealt with people eating dog food, and you give them food, and they're just devouring it, and crying so happy for some second. I'm eating the burger, and I see the guy hungry, and I said, I ain't got no money, but you want my... He ate my burger, you feel me? That's hunger. We don't know that kind of hunger. Most of us don't. You see? Joseph is poor, and we can get by with a lot less. You see, we can consume a lot of this, we can do, and we can get into this mentality. And Pope Francis is pushing this. Throw out the lawnmower. I need a new lawnmower blade. Well, that's going to be $35. I can get a new lawnmower for $119. It's at the road. The bicycle at the road. Man, we picked that stuff up. You know, what you going to do with that? They're going to put it on my tombstone. What you going to do with that? So we fix these things. And we're willing maybe to spend more money than it's worth to fix it. Just to, in your face, you see, that we got to get away from just consuming things and throwing them out. There's only so many landfills we can fill up. So poor. The poor, it's interesting. as the Ben Esserai would say, as the state of living increases, morality and spirituality decreases. That's a general economic spiritual principle. The poor countries have saints. And I'm not saying we need to be poor. I'm saying we need to be poor in spirit. We need to downsize. Not supersize. We need to downsize. And we need to stop wasting. Joseph was a man who was poor. And he had the rich God under his care. That's a lesson for us. Joseph is a pater. Huh? He's a father. And and this is something I think we can learn finally with St. Joseph, Pope Francis's letter. He's a beloved father. We love Joseph. He was loved by Mary. He was loved by Jesus. Jesus was honored to be called the son of the carpenter. They meant it as a slam. And Jesus said, thank you for calling me a carpenter. Thank you for referring to me as the son of the carpenter, Joseph. He was honored. He loved his father. A tender and loving father. He was tender. This is something beautiful. The caress of Joseph. Big manly man. But how he caressed Jesus. How he was tender with Mary. We need strength and tenderness. You got to be holy for that. Men, we're either macho and rough or we're wimpy. But to have strength and tenderness in the same man, that's Joseph. That's sanctity. You got to have holiness. It's not an art. It's virtue. He's an obedient father. He went all the way to Bethlehem. Mary's 8.5 months pregnant. And he goes with a mule, a donkey, to Bethlehem because the president says you got to do it. Or the governor says you got to do it. I'd say, are you kidding me? I'm taking care of the son of God, buddy. You can stay with, we'll jump in a lake. Disobedience always gets us in a pickle. That's why we die, disobedience. That's why evil came into the world, disobedience. Obedience, whether you agree with it or not, you see, obedience, as long as there's a legitimate command from a legitimate superior. Joseph knows that he's obedient to civil authority, he's obedient to divine authority. He heard, he got up, and he did. We are not, and I'm obedient as long as I like what they're telling me and I agree with it. But as soon as then there's something wrong with it. That's going on in the church right now. If we don't like it, I'm going to get my own church. Schumann's ministers. You talk about a dead end there, huh? Oh yeah, we cut ourselves off from grace. Obedience. An accepting father. So he accepted. Amen. He didn't like the situation. He accepted it, that he had to go to Bethlehem to register. He accepted the fact that he had to close his boutique and be able to have to do without in order to be present to this mandate of going to church on Sunday. You see? He was creatively courageous, Father. This is beautiful. I never heard this before, but Pope Francis says that God could have fixed Herod in an instant. God could have fixed all these difficulties. He didn't have to go all the way to Egypt. But God didn't. And he let Joseph, in his courage, be creative. And look what happened. Look how powerful things can be when we're in a bind and we really got to pray and agonize and put our heads together and say, oh, look, let's do this. Huh? That's what he did. He was creative in his courage. And this is what we see in Father. My dad was very creative. As the babies came, every time a new baby would come, he'd build a new greenhouse. Because he liked to grow plants. It was a hobby. And then he got this idea, I'm going to keep them off the streets and make them work in the greenhouse. And I'll have a little business. And whatever money they get, at the end of the year, I'm going to put it in a little account for them to go to college. Because dad couldn't afford it. He couldn't afford to feed us, much less to send us to college. You know something? All nine of us went to college. All went to college on that little greenhouse kitty. It was pretty, I'll say, well, that's pretty. And he said, no, it was like, I was trying to figure out how we're going to do this, you see. The only reason I went to college is because when I graduated from high school, I hated school, and I was going offshore. I was taking a job, $12.50 an hour, working offshore. And so I said, Dad, I'm going to take that money, buy me a pickup truck, I'm going offshore. He said, no, son. He said, you don't have to go to college, you can go offshore, that's fine. I'm not forcing you to go to college. But that money is for college. And if you don't go to college, I'm going to give that money to your sisters. I'm telling you, the only reason I went to college was to keep my sister from getting that money. Now, I realize that's, I have to confess that. You say, but that's where I was back then. Anyway, so I got my degree too. All right. And then a working father, we already talked about that. He wasn't lazy. And a father in the shadows. to always to be willing to be in the shadow of God the Father. Your father and I have been worried sick about you. Why did you do this to his son? My father and you, didn't you know I must be about my father's affairs? And Joseph is fine with that. Joseph was always willing to be subservient to somebody else's project. We men, it's got to be my idea. That's how women manipulate us. Women are not suffering from pride. They just want the new kitchen or something. Or they want you to renovate the, or finish putting the crown mold in the bedroom or something that you haven't done. You know, you own a construction company, you still haven't finished your own house. I mean, I know that. All right. Well, what does a woman do? She goes, oh, that's a brilliant idea. You know, Lewis, about, you know, such and such and such, you know. What's my brilliant idea? How about redoing the kitchen? You see? But anyway, you just throw it as their idea, and then men will jump on the project. But if it's not my project, I don't have anything to do with it. Stupidity of pride. Joseph was happy to be in the shadow. He did his job in the background. That's St. Joseph. We don't have that today, men. I gotta have a little plaque, you know, donated by Father Champagne. I gotta have a little, you know, a little Scooby snack, you see? A little T-Fan, you see, to ring if I make a little donation. Not St. Joseph. Joseph was a servant. He was happy to be in the shadow of the Father. You see, I am a useless servant, only doing my due. So this is St. Joseph, some aspects of St. Joseph as we are culminating our mission with the Holy Family. Our Lady of the Sacred Heart, Jesus, Our Lady of the Sacred Heart, and St. Joseph, the custos of the Sacred Heart, the custodian of the Sacred Heart. So let's...